good afternoon, folks. Is that a bit loud at the back? Hi, thank you very much for giving up your Saturday afternoon to come along and sit in a cold church hall and listen to me waffle on for a while. What we're hoping to do today is to go over the Cromarty Firth Port Authority application for the transfer of oil from ship at sea. And I'll use that term at sea quite a lot throughout this presentation because I think that's a really important aspect. We are Cromarty Rising, you might have heard. We were delighted this week when we were referred to in the press as a high profile pressure group. Whoa! We've made it. But I'll introduce us. We've got Arthur Bird over here, looking very smart. He's a management consultant, originally from Cromarty and comes back to Cromarty as often as he can. Next to him we have Dr. Greg Fullerton, who's our environmental expert. And on the end there, hiding round the corner, our oil industry expert, and he is Duncan Bowers. And Duncan's worked in the oil industry for over 30 years, and his specialism was oil risk assessment. So how lucky are we in Cromarty to have an environmental expert, an oil specialist, and a management consultant all willing to get their hands dirty and fight this application. My name's Jacqui Ross, better not forget that, and I live in Cromarty, a long-term resident, was born and brought up there, and I feel very passionately about this application and trying to put a halt to it. So that's why I'm giving up my Saturday afternoon to do this. I've put this picture here. This is Cromarty Firth. And this is when you walk along the front in Cromarty, this is actually what you see. And in the press last week, or the week before, we collectively were called NIMBYs. And actually, this is our backyard, you know. So you can't say that we're not used to development. Industrial development has gone on in the Cromarty Firth for 30 years. People of Cromarty have lived with large numbers of oil rigs, various sizes and shapes, coming in at all times of the year. We've lived with tags going up and down, tankers, cruise ships, the whole shebang for 30 years. We're not NIMBYs. But this application is the straw that broke the camel's back as far as we're concerned. We completely disagree with it. The risk is too high in an area that is too sensitive. And that's why we're trying to put across our views. I want to just go very quickly through what the application is. Some of you will be very aware of the application. Some of you may not be sure of what it actually is. So, in December of last year, the Cromarty Firth Port Authority applied for an oil transfer licence. And they've been sort of saying that this licence isn't anything new. It's something that they've been doing already. But I actually had a conversation with Stan Rosnicki, who is the guy at the Maritime and Coast Guard Agency who's dealing with this. I spoke to him personally, and he said that the Port Authority were asked to put this application in because what they were proposing was completely different from what they've been doing in the past. Okay? So this is not an extension to an application, it's not a renewal of an application, it's a completely different process. Now the Port Authority are very clever at not actually telling you that. So it's important that we understand that in the past, all of the transfers, and there have been oil transfers, we're not saying that, it's been in the Cromarty Firth for a number of years, have been done at the Nigg jetty. So they have been anchored to shore, and this has not been done at sea. And the average oil transfer was 1 million tonnes a year. And this is a huge increase in that amount. So that's why this application has gone in. Something else that's worth noting here is that the substance that's going to be transferred is North Sea crude oil from various fields. We don't know where this oil is coming from. The Baltic states, Russia, we don't know. The quality of the oil, the quality of the ships, we have no idea. So it's interesting that that information is in there. Okay, the development is to have 5 anchorage points in the Cromarty Port area. And those anchorage points are at different locations, and they will be used only one anchorage point at a time, is what the Port Authority are telling us. They will pick a different anchorage point dependent on the weather and the wind and so on. But these tankers, 250 metres long, will come in, they'll be anchored up, you'll have a mother tanker that will be tethered to the daughter tanker, the hoses will be connected and the oil transfer will take place. You can't really see the scale of these vessels there, but 250 metres is a pretty big vessel. And when they're actually taking that process, when the transfers are taking place, there's a 500 metre exclusion zone around that as well. So that's going to have a huge impact on the local fleet. You know, sailing, any eco-ventures, any boats that are out there, they're not going to go within 500 metres of a transfer when it's taking place. And the figures. And I've put, it's not overly obvious there, but I have put the words average in bold for a reason. The Port Authority are hoping to do 48 transfers per year on average. Okay, that is a maximum figure, they can't do more than that. And on average, 4 transfers per calendar month. And when you think about that, we're saying, well, 4 transfers a month, and even though it's 1 a week, it's not a huge amount. But when we question the Port Authority about that, that's an average figure. Actually, transfers will only take place in good weather. So the likelihood is that those 48 transfers will take place during May, June, July, August, the summer months. They're not going to be doing transfers during the winter months. It's too risky. So although it's an average of 4 per calendar month, that's not how it's going to pan out. And quite a lot of information that we get from the Port Authority is, it sounds really good, but realistically it's not how it's going to pan out. I think we could repeat that phrase over and over. But something else that's interesting here, it's 8.6 million tonnes a year. So that's 8 times more than they were transferring before at the jetty. So we're at sea, it's more risky, and there's 8 times more oil being transferred. And that's why, you know, we are concerned. 24 hours a day, when a transfer is taking place in the summer months, in order to pump 180,000 tonnes of oil, you have to pump for 24 hours. So you've got your 2 ships running, you've got your tugs holding them in place, making sure that nothing goes wrong, on standby in case something does go wrong, you've got the engines running and the pumping running for 24 hours a day. And I'll come back to the noise and that later on. So that's what they're proposing, and we're not particularly happy about it. This is where they're proposing. So that the boundary line there, the purple boundary line, is the boundary of the Port Authority area. In order to do ship-to-ship transfers, it has to be within the Port Authority area. So these anchorages are really close to shore. Anchorage 14 is just over a kilometre from the cliffs of the South Souter. So that is really close to shore. And those of you, if you've had a look out at the Moray Firth there is a cold stacked oil rig at the moment sitting out there on its own, and it's actually anchorage point 18A. So that's the top corner of the boundary. So you have 5 anchorage points, and as I said earlier, they'll rotate around those depending on wind and weather. Something that's also important to note about the location, I think everybody realises that the Cromarty Firth and the Moray Firth are protected areas. There's a range of protection on those areas. So we can't honestly believe that the Port of Cromarty Firth can get away with this risky business when there are so many protected areas around there. And finally, about location, when we started doing our research, I think this was the graphic that really made it hit home for us. Professor Paul Thompson, he came along to our public meeting in Cromarty in October and went over his views, and again I'll come back to that a little bit later. But through his research, he's carried out research on cetaceans in Moray Firth for over 30 years. And through his research documents, we found this graphic on the left there. And it shows the dolphin density. So you can see at Shannonry Point, there's a hot spot for dolphins, but the mouth of the Cromarty Firth between the two suitors is a real hot spot for breeding and feeding of our local resident population of bottlenose dolphins. And then you superimpose the map on the right that shows where the anchorages are, and the anchorages are right in the middle of the dolphin breeding and feeding grounds. So you couldn't, you know, in our opinion, you couldn't pick a worse place for it. We talk about dolphins, but we've also got to remember that in the Moray Firth and the Cromarty Firth, there's a lot of other wildlife that needs protection. The bird colonies are phenomenal there. We have porpoises, we have sea otters, we have seals. And on the 1st of October, I keep going back to say it with a big smile on our face, when Humpy, our little humpback, big humpback, appeared in front of Sarah's boat with a full passenger, you know, a boat full of passengers, and what an experience. But you know, we have a humpback whale. And another one, thanks for the photos, Sarah, that another photo here we have the same humpback quail, and having a look at that, that quail is exactly on anchor point 16. So that's why we're trying to protect this. And if you look at that, you can see how close anchor point 16, it's one of the further away ones, how close that anchorage point is to the South Sutor Cliffs. So once the application closed, the consultation period closed on the 9th of February this year, all of the representations went to the Maritime and Coast Guard Agency, and there were 340 representations made, including our own. There's a list there of the representations that we have on our Cromarty Rising website, and if you want more information, I would advise you to go and have a look. But really, worryingly, if you go and have a look at the SNH representation, the RSPB one, and the one from Professor Paul Thompson, these are experts in their field, they have grave concerns about various aspects of this application. And recently, a number of these organisations have clubbed together to have a press release to say that they were against this application. So if you've got the time, go on and have a look and see exactly what these organisations are saying about what the proposals. So that's historical. What's happening now? And this is a bit where, as a lay person, I get rather confused and angry. All of the representations that were lodged with the Maritime and Coast Guard Agency were then directly sent to the Cromarty Firth Port Authority. The Cromarty Firth Port Authority can then sift through all of that information, all of the advice, all of the criticisms, all of the errors, and they have had, since February, time to look at that information and are now getting the opportunity to rewrite their application. So at this moment in time, the Port Authority are rewriting their application based on the information that's been given to them by us. And I don't think that's right. If you're going to put forward an application to do something as risky as this, in my opinion, you should get it right the first time round and not the second time round once all your failings have been highlighted. But that's the situation. It's important that we remember that this hasn't gone away. The Port Authority are going to resubmit their application sometime soon, and we'll see how many boxes they've ticked. We have found the Port Authority to be less than helpful throughout this campaign. We've invited them to public meetings. They were invited to come along here today, and they refused to do so or declined our invitation. But they did ask us to write a detailed report of our concerns and give it in to them based on this meeting, which we're obviously not going to do. But they've stabbed us at various occasions. They don't come to public meetings unless they're controlling those meetings. They've come to a couple of meetings in Cromarty that were closed, closed meetings, no members of the public allowed. And when 38 EVs went to hand in a petition, an online petition, they refused to come out and actually accept that petition. The woman that came out from London to hand it in had to hand it in at reception. Yet, time and time again in the press, they say that they are engaging with the community, that they are engaging with community councils, that they are engaging with the public, that they're listening. That's not the experience that we're having. Maybe it's just because they don't like us, but we're certainly not getting that experience. And we have embarked on a campaign, a media campaign. The PR that the court are getting at the moment is not great, and they know that. And this week, it was on Thursday or Friday morning, they released this document here, which is the Cromarty Firth Port Authority ship-to-ship update document. So they have released a document that they have produced using a PR media company that's into crisis management from Glasgow. So they have now employed a PR company to produce this glossy brochure. We've been through the glossy brochure. We feel that it still contains the same inaccuracies, the same factual errors, the same spin that they've been spouting for the last 10 months. There's nothing new in the brochure for us, but if you were a lay person reading it, it sounds like this is the best thing since sliced bread. You look at that, it is perfect. This is the perfect thing, but you have to be realistic. They say things like, we will do this, we will, but actually will they? And I'm not sure about that. So I want to go through our concerns. I've cut this down because we could be here till Christmas going through our concerns, but I want to pick out some of the key concerns. At the end, if you do have any questions about the specifics, the gentleman will be able to answer the details. They've put all of this together, they know this inside out. Our first concern is that their oil spill planning, or contingency planning, we feel is lacking. The Port Authority have based this application on the SCAPA flow application, so they've copied and pasted a lot of information from an existing application. And in that application, a company were employed to decide what the oil spill volume should be, what they should model in their plan. And that company, Briggs Marine, if I'm right, Duncan, it said that the oil spill volume should be 300,000 tonnes. So what should be modelled, in other words, what should be looked at, what should be planned for, is an oil spill of 300,000 tonnes. The Maritime and Coast Guard Agency decided to change that oil spill volume to one tonne. So all the modelling in this application is based on a maximum oil spill of one tonne. That's not realistic. That's not realistic. You would hope that there was never a major oil spill, but they should have modelled that, and they haven't. And in their documentation, they proudly say that within 30 minutes, a small boom could be on site if there was an oil spill. And a small boom could be on site to deal with 250 litres of an oil spill. And they say that there's a plan if there's a major oil spill, but they don't actually say what it is and they haven't modelled it. So they don't know if there's a 50,000 litre spill, they don't know how long it's going to take to hit Nairn Beach, or Rosmarket Beach, or get up the Firth, because that hasn't been modelled. And that's one of our major concerns. The noise, there's 24-hour pumping. It's outside the suitors, on a nice calm day, that is going to travel far and wide. The noise is going to be loud, there's no doubt about it, there's lots of vessels there. There's going to be the release of VOCs, and there's going to be diesel fumes. And if you look at the incidence of diesel fumes and noise in Southwold, where this already happens, there are huge problems with that. In fact, primary school there had to be closed because of fumes. In their glossy document, they have made no reference to noise or fumes at all. And in the application, the Maritime and Coast Guard Agency have said that air pollution, as it says there, is not considered appropriate, not worried about it, and they're not worried about VOCs or any other kind of air pollution at all. So they're not taking that into consideration still. Greg has done a huge amount of work to try and work out what the ecosystem service value is. And what that means is how much money we're getting in from the environment. So we've got tourism and accommodation and businesses and all of those kinds of things. And if you put all of that together, the Cromarty and Moray Firth generates £464 million to the ecosystem. This application will take in £750,000 per annum for the Port Authority. There's a bit of a discrepancy there. Why are they risking our ecosystem for £750,000 per year? And that's if they have maximum number of transfers. On top of that, they're boldly publicising the fact that there's going to be an increase in their cruise ship business by 40%. And to me, I don't see how the two things sit together. You want to have all these tourists coming in, the cruise ships are coming in, they're coming in through the mouth of the Cromarty Firth, passing by large tankers full of oil, spouting nice smells of diesel and so on. The two things just don't sit well together. And in the application, the Maritime and Coast Guard Agency say that this is an environmental issue, not a social and economic one. So there has been no modelling done. If there's a spill, there's been nothing done about what the effect that would be on the local economy at all. And that we believe that's a failing. Through our research, people in Cromarty know us quite well now, and we've had people come up and give us information and ask questions. One of the things that's been brought up has been about an existing war grave. And there was a ship, MV Shelbert, that went down in the Moray Firth in 1940. It hit a mine, and it was making its way to Cromarty to try and save itself when it sank, and all life on board was lost. Now, we asked the Port Authority about that. They've acknowledged that the wreck is there. They know it's there. It's been dived. We know the location of it. And they say in their documents that it won't be impacted by this. It won't be impacted at all. We know it's there. It'll be fine. Then you look at the map, and the MV Shelbert is positioned right under Anchorage 15. It's just another one of the comments they make. It will be fine. We won't touch it. How can they guarantee that? These ships have huge anchor chains. There's wind, there's tide. How can they guarantee that that war grave will not be damaged? They can't, but yet they say they will. This is one that we're really working on at the moment, and it's great to have some of our colleagues from there and here. As far as the Moray Firth is concerned, the Cromarty Firth Port Authority believe that they are the Cromarty Firth Port Authority, and they're not actually consulting with anyone around the Moray Firth at all. They've done no consultation with the Moray Firth side of the Black Isle, Fort Rosmarkey, Nairn, but this transfer site is in the Moray Firth. It's not in the Cromarty Firth. Actually, we're not going to see it in Cromarty at all. It's over the back of the Souter. But you'll see it from Nairn, and you'll see it from Rosmarkey, and you'll see it from the Keswick Bridge, actually. But there has been no consultation done with any of these communities. And even with our consultation, this comment has been coming out time and time again from the Port Authority, that of the 9 community councils, only 3 have confirmed that they're against the ship-to-ship, and that's 17% of the population. And what they're implying is, if your community council hasn't opposed this officially, then that community is not opposed to this application. And that's absolute nonsense. Some community councils didn't even know about it at the time. It went under the radar. Some community councils are very small, run, you know, it's all volunteers. They didn't have the capacity to actually respond at that time. So we've been looking into that as well. And of the community councils that we've been able to contact so far, 18 have come out as opposed. We're still working. We haven't got all of the responses yet. We've put a survey out. We're waiting for some responses. But 18 community councils are opposed at this point in time. If you live in one of the sort of beige pinky areas where we don't know whether you're opposed or not, please get in touch with your community council and share your views and ask them to share their views with us, because this is powerful information for us that we can use against the Port Authority when they throw out these glib statements. The jetty. In the Port Authority document, you will find very little reference to the jetty. They don't really state that ship transfers have always taken place up to the jetty. They're not mentioning why they're not using the jetty now. And in the press recently, the owners of the jetty have stated that they're concerned about the loss of 40 jobs because the jetty is being underutilised. So on one side, you've got an organisation who wants to carry out ship-to-ship transfers. On the other side, you've got an organisation that has a jetty that could safely allow ship-to-ship transfers, and yet the connection has not been made. And we don't know why that is. The Port Authority are being very silent on it, and we can't find out the reason for that. But as I say, there's very, very little reference to the jetty in their documentation. And our last concern for today is the population of bottlenose dolphins. And as I mentioned, Professor Paul Thompson, in his parting shot at the Cromarty meeting, just said that if you were looking for a bad place to do it, you couldn't find a worse one than this in Europe. There's no worse place to do ship-to-ship oil transfers in Europe than this one. And that was a fantastic statement for us, because that's exactly what we believe. And then you look at what the Port Authority are saying, and this, I think, is the statement from the documentation that really has frustrated me the most. Because they go on about their transfers taking place for 30 years. We all know that that's been at the jetty, which is inside the Cromarty Firth, which is at shore, which is not in an area of high dolphin population. And the reason that the resident dolphin population has increased is because they are being left alone, they have great feeding grounds, they've got great breeding grounds, and it's all hunky-dory. And yet, this is the statement that they're making. This is not the same location. They can't make a statement like that. It's just not true. So that's what you're going to find littered throughout this documentation. Just on the dolphins, a couple of slides before I finish off, but Paul Thompson said, you know, we were all concerned about a huge oil spill and the impact that an oil spill would have on the dolphins. And the Port Authority application says, but the dolphins will swim away. And Paul Thompson says, actually, they won't swim away. They live there. So they'll just swim through it. And they'll get, you know, over time, there will be disease and so on. It's, you know, it's an issue. But he said, actually, the process itself is an issue. Because it's not just the oil spill. The disturbance, the 24-hour noise in an area where they feed and they breed, is going to have an impact. We don't know what that impact is because the Port Authority haven't modelled it or looked into it. There could be direct injury. We looked at the number of propellers that are going to be involved. It's thousands over the year. There could be propeller strikes. And there will be pollution of some kind. There could be VOC pollution, there could be pollution, just small spills, there could be some kind of pollution. That could have an effect on the prey that's available, and long term could cause disease. And what Paul Thompson was saying was that that disease could then reduce the number of infants that are born, or babies that are born, and could increase issues with the dolphin's health over the long term, and could then lead to a reduction in the population. On the application, I'm not over this at all, but that's what Paul said about the application. It was outdated and insufficient, and they should consider an alternative site, a lower risk site, and SEPA actually agreed with that. So, what are we doing? Well, we created Cromarty Rising. We didn't do that for any flashy reason. We just needed to have a name to put to press releases and things like that. And that was what we came up with one Sunday afternoon at Duncan's. We've also created a website to gather all of this information. So as I say, if you want information about it, go onto the Cromarty Rising website. But our main aim has been to keep the interest, the media interest, and build awareness of this application. We found over the months that interest has sort of waned, and we've been working really hard to keep it in the press and to build awareness. That's why we're here today. We want more people to be aware that this is a really risky application, and we need to have a groundswell of opinion to try and oppose it. We've been writing letters to MSPs, MPs. I'm sure you've had letters, emails by the dozen. And we've been in the North Star, the Rossshire, the Herald, the National Radio, Mudcliffe Radio, BBC Radio, and so on. But lately, one of the things that we've done is we have sought legal advice from Bindmans, who are a very well respected London law firm. People have been asking why we've done that. We did it for various reasons. One, we wanted the Port Authority to see that we're actually very serious about this, that we're not just crons that are being noisy. We also knew that the application was not very high quality, and we wanted Bindmans to have a look at that, to look at the application and see if there were any legal issues that we could catch them on, which there were quite a number of legal questions. We also again wanted to raise the profile. So we have engaged Bindmans, and Bindmans will be, if this application is awarded, if the Port Authority managed to tick all the boxes and the Maritime and Coast Guard Agency award it in February, Bindmans will be our representation if we take it further and we try and get a judicial review and fight it in court. We're going to take it all the way. We intend to do that, and Bindmans will be our legal firm for that. So, the reason we're holding these meetings is because we need people to be aware. We need people to make a noise. We need people to engage their communities and be active. We want you to contact your Highland councillor. Now, there is a specific reason for that, because when this application is resubmitted, the public are not consulted again. We have no say on the second application. The only people that are our representatives that have a say are the local authority. So the Highland councillors will have a chance to look at the second application and submit something to the Maritime and Coast Guard Agency. So your Highland councillor is the only way that you can have that representation made. So please get in touch with them and make your views known. Your MSP, your MP as well, and contact the Port Authority, let them know how you feel. They don't particularly like it. And if your community council hasn't made representation, particularly to the Highland Council, please get on to them. Let them know how you feel. Go to the community council meeting, ask them what they're doing about it, and share on social media. And if we have to take this to judicial review, it's going to cost money. And we need to raise funds to do that. And we have a Just Giving page, and you can find the link to that on the Cromarty Rising website. So we need your support, and we need you to spread the word, and we don't have an awful long time, because this application could go back in January, and we need to be ready for that if it happens. Okay? So, thank you for listening to me for a very long period of time. I'm going to hand over to John now, who is going to give you his views on this application. Okay, John.